Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our webinar for National Science Week. This year's theme is Food Different by Design. So today we'll be talking about how the Bureau, the South Australian Government, and the South Australian Research and Development Institute are using weather and climate services to help the aquaculture industry. For those joining us for the first time, welcome. And for anyone who has joined us for our webinars before, welcome back. Before we begin proceedings, I would like to acknowledge and pay respect to the Kulin Nations, who are the traditional custodians of the land on which we meet. I would also like to acknowledge and pay respect to the traditional custodians of all the lands that we are gathered on in all states and territories, and pay my respects to their elders past, present, and emerging. We acknowledge and respect their continuing culture and contribution they make to Australia. My name is Jordan, and I will be your moderator today. I'm joined by Claire, who will be producing today's webinar. Together, we will help make the webinar as interactive as possible. But before we start, may I ask for your attention as we cover off some housekeeping items. With the current situation as it is in Australia, this webinar will be conducted from our respective homes and office spaces across the country. Please bear this in mind as we may encounter some technical issues during the broadcast. Our broadcast will run for 60 minutes with plenty of time allocated for questions, and this webinar is being recorded, so you'll be able to view it as we share it on an email later, hopefully today. Frank, can you go to the next slide, please? For first-time webinar attendees, please see some helpful tips on your screen. Most importantly, please note the chat box, where you can send through any questions or feedback for the presenters. Please use this box and not the Q&A box to send us your questions during the session, and we will answer as many as possible during the allocated breaks. It is the speech bubble button on the right of your screen. The icon will turn blue once it's on. If you want to test out the chat box now, feel free to tell us your name and where you're dialing in from. And thank you to everyone who has sent us questions during the registration process. We've used them to help shape the content you'll see today, and we'll get through as many as we can. I'm just going to check in with Frank and make sure that everything's all right, because we haven't gone to any of the next screens. Frank, everything okay?
Yes, Jordan, I'm just trying to move on.
All right, I will soldier on, but we will, there we are. Here are your presenters for today. Firstly, from the Bureau, we have Senior Research Scientist, Dr. Frank Colberg. From the Department of Primary Industry and Regions in South Australia, Associate Professor Shane Roberts, who is the General Manager of Aquaculture. And lastly, Dr. Mark Doubell, Research Scientist in Oceanography for the South Australian Research and Development Institute. So big heavy hitters today. Frank holds a PhD degree in physical oceanography and joined the ocean modelling team in the research program of the Bureau in 2015. Over the past 6 years, the ocean modeler team has developed ocean models over the Great Barrier Reef, parts of the Great Australian Bight, and various locations for the Australian Defence Force. Dr. Mark Doubell leads the oceanography subprogram at the South Australian Research and Development Institute, which is a state government's principal research institute. Mark and his team has undertaken cross-disciplinary oceanographic research, which spans spatial scales from millimetres to hundreds of kilometres. This work encompasses in situ studies of physical and biological processes and their couplings, which influence the structure and functioning of marine ecosystems, as well as the modelling of shelf and coastal systems. And lastly, Associate Professor Shane Roberts is the General Manager of Aquaculture at the Department of Primary Industries and Regions. The regulatory authority is for the South Australian seafood industry. Shane has over 20 years experience in fisheries, aquaculture, and aquatic animal health, including research, management, legislation, and policy development. Shane was the principal investigator of the FRDC project being presented at this webinar. So that's probably the longest introduction I've ever done for people. So you know that these guys are your absolute experts. They're the best possible people for today's webinar. Next slide, please. We have a packed hour for you today, including: what is Pacific Oyster Mortality Syndrome? How the Bureau's ocean modelling helped with managing Pacific Oyster Mortality Syndrome? And what the outcomes were for the SA oyster industry? Let's not keep you waiting any longer and get straight to Mark. He'll start us off with an overview of POMS. Don't forget, you can get your questions answered today, so send them in as soon as you think of them. It's the little speech bubble button but right-hand side of your taskbar. Send in and we'll get to them as many as we can. All yours, Mark.
Thank you, Jordan, and good morning, everybody. Thanks for listening in. I'm going to start the webinar, first part of the webinar off, and provide a little bit of background information on the aquaculture industry in South Australia, and then some more details about the Pacific Oyster Mortality Syndrome and what we need to be able to model the syndrome. Next slide, please, Frank. So here we have an overview of the aquaculture industry in South Australia. In total, in 1920, it had a total value of about $229 million at the farm gate, with a flow-on effect and a total industry value then, including flow-ons, of about $600 million. If we have a look at the top pie graph on the left, we can see that the oyster industry is about produces about 1/6 of the total aquaculture production in South Australia. And that production is made up of land and marine-based aquaculture species, with the main industry sectors being marine finfish, oysters, mussels, abalone, and some freshwater species with freshwater finfish, marrin and yabbies. As you can see on the map on the right, these industries are located all across the state, and many of them in our regional areas away from the main city of Adelaide. And with global fisheries now at near maximum levels, then the future growth, aquaculture is seen as a future growth industry to supply the world's protein needs. Next slide, please. So a little bit more on the South Australian oyster industry. It's actually the largest oyster industry in Australia. And in South Australia, it has a value of about $40 million per year at the farm gate. And it consists of 332 licenses held across 115 farms, and it's responsible for the employment of 118 jobs. And that's largely out in the regional areas. Again, the map there shows Adelaide, and we can see most of the oyster growing areas are located at some distance from Adelaide. We also have a picture on the bottom left showing the beautiful products that are produced by the South Australian oyster industry as they're farmed in some very pristine regional waters. Next slide, please. So a little bit about what is the Pacific Oyster Mortality Syndrome. Well, it's a disease which only affects Pacific oysters. It's actually harmless to humans, and it's caused by a virus called the ostrich herpes virus. On the bottom right figure there, we can see an electron microscope image of the virus, and it's about 50 nanometers in radius, or about 0.1 micron in diameter, so it's very small. And the virus causes the rapid death and high mortalities in Pacific oysters, and it can spread quickly when it's introduced. So the bottom schematic there basically shows the viruses infecting some oysters. Within the oysters, then viral replication takes place, and the oyster, as it dies, releases the disease, and then it's released into the water column where it can be transmitted to affect other oysters, both close by and at some distance, as this presentation will show. Next slide, please. So how does POMS affect Pacific oysters? Well, as we know, oysters are bivalves and have two shells. POMS weakens the oysters through causing metabolic disorder, and this causes the valves of the oysters to open and ultimately results in their death. As I mentioned before, it causes high mortality rates of up to 100% in juvenile oysters, or what we call spat. And there's a picture of spat there on the right. On the top right in the gentleman's hands. For older oysters in the age bracket of 1 to 2 years, it causes about 80% mortality. And for, again, older oysters of 4 years of older, it causes about 50% mortality rates. Importantly, we know that POMS outbreaks are temperature dependent. And in fact, there's an increase in the spread and the mortality of the disease occurs with increasing water temperatures. And in South Australia, there's a critical temperature of approximately 17 degrees where disease spread and mortality increases. As for the virus itself, it has an incubation period of about 4 to 5 days, and the virus survives for 2 days in the water. But it's important to note that the virus DNA survives for up to 22 days. And Shane will touch on about this more about this later, because this is important when they undertake surveillance and are trying to detect the virus to monitor and manage the situation of POMS. The main sign of POMS outbreak is high mortality rates. And we see up to 100% mortality happening very quickly within about 8 to 10 days of infection. Next slide, please. Okay, so POMS transmission. Well, in South Australia, it was first detected in Port Adelaide on the 28th of February in 2018. The map on the top left there shows a picture of the state, and in the red box, we have Adelaide, which is situated very close by to the Port River. A zoom in of the Port River is shown on the right there, on the map on the top right, and from the river, authorities and the industry were particularly concerned about the potential spread of the river to the most nearby commercial oyster farms, which are located on the other side of Gulf St. Vincent, about 60 kilometres away, and further south down off of Kangaroo Island. So the transmission pathways of the virus include the movement of infected oysters. This can be either as livestock, such as spat, to oyster farms, or through vessel movement and biofouling issues with feral oysters on the bottom of ships. It can also be transmitted through contaminated equipment, or, as we study more in this project, through the natural water movement through ocean currents. When the outbreak was detected, PERSA implemented a strict containment measures to keep the virus in check. This included the removal of feral bivalves being banned from the Port River. They undertook a feral oyster eradication program, increased surveillance, and put out a communication and awareness campaign to the public and to the oyster industry. As we'll go on more to show in this presentation, ocean modelling was used to understand the disease's natural dispersal and transmission due to ocean water movements. Next slide, please. So how do we go about modelling? Well, Frank, in his next section, is going to talk about the development of the ocean models, but we also need to consider some of the biological aspects of the disease. So this requires coupling of both physical and biological models. So for the physical, as Frank will tell you about in the upcoming slides, there were high-resolution hydrodynamic models developed by both the Bureau of Meteorology and SARDI in partnership to predict the ocean movement and circulation. To predict the trajectory of POMS and dispersal of POMS, we had to understand the biological characteristics, and then we then simulated the movement within the ocean models using a particle tracking model called LTRANS. Some of the biological model assumptions that we had to program in for our virtual viruses included the fact that the viral survival period in water is for 2 days, and it largely within a temperature range of about 16 to 20 degrees in South Australia. For those surveillance purposes, we needed to understand and model the virus out for a total period of 22 days, because this is the period that the DNA is detectable in the water. We also had to assume, because of their small size, that they're non-motile. This means they're essentially a passive trace of the water movement and are at the mercy of ocean currents. And then we undertook this modelling for a number of hypothetical seasonal outbreak scenarios, where we modelled dispersal over summer, autumn and spring periods for up to 23 sites across the 11 oyster growing regions in South Australia. The graph on the bottom, in the middle there, shows some predictions of the oyster dispersal, which Frank and Shane will talk about more. And on the bottom, we can calculate dispersal distances and times from the model outcomes. But these will be expanded on in the coming slides. And finally, I guess we use these results to quantify the POMS dispersal, and these are needed to define better disease management areas and enhance future disease surveillance and emergency response programs, as Shane will talk about soon. Okay, next slide, please. I think that's it for me. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Mark, for starting us off today. Great start. Before Frank and Shane give us an inside look at what we're doing to fight POMS, we've got some time to take your questions. Remember, hit the little speech bubble button on the right of your taskbar and start sending them in. We have the full team on deck, so we should be able to get to all your questions, and I know this team loves some curly ones. So Mark is going to answer our first question, which I think is perfect person for it. Does this disease affect other marine life, Mark?
Good question, and very quick off the bat there. Fortunately, this disease is species specific, meaning it only affects Pacific, commercial Pacific oysters. So in this case, we're very lucky that it is species specific, and no, it does not affect other marine life.
Okay, fantastic. Shane, we've got a question for you now, so I'm going to bring him in. How many oysters died in the 2018 event, and how many events have we had since then?
Thanks, Jordan. Yeah, it's a good question. In 2018 in South Australia, like Mark just said, it just affected the Port River. So they are all wild oysters, no farmed oysters there. So that would have been in the millions, wild feral oysters. And thankfully, in the farms across the rest of the state, there were no mortalities, which was good. In terms of how many events since then, every summer since 2018, we have seen mortalities of those wild oysters in the port. So each summer, when the water temperatures increase, we do see the disease present itself again.
Okay. We have a question for, again, Shane. What financial impact has POMS had on the industry?
Thanks, Jordan. Yeah, I mean, it's been, and I'll talk about it later, a huge financial impact interstate in New South Wales and Tasmania, of course. But in South Australia, there was an indirect impact. In 2016, when the POMS virus made it to Tasmania, a lot of our small baby oysters, which are called spat, came from hatcheries down there. So in 2016, we had to shut the borders to those hatcheries. And the industry here fell from about $40 million a year to $20-odd million a year, so almost half. So that was an indirect impact. But in terms of the disease in 2018, not a significant impact at all, thankfully.
Okay. I hope I'm saying this name correctly, so sorry if I mispronounce it, but Jian would like to know, what is the pathohistological, sorry if I got that wrong as well, presentation or feature of this virus?
Yeah, so the virus kills quite rapidly. The main diagnostic technique we use is PCR, which is detecting the DNA. Mark touched on before that the disease rapidly affects the metabolic system of the animal. It dies very quick, but for diagnostic purposes, takes too long to do histology. We use PCR for rapid detection techniques. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in the surveillance slides.
Okay. Mark, I think this question is good for you since you answered the first question. Marty has got a follow-up to that question. And if you've forgotten what the first question was, is does this disease affect other marine life? Marty would like to know, but can it infect other species as carriers?
It can affect other oyster species. I believe it doesn't cause the mortality, but they can act as carriers.
Okay. Claire has asked, are there plans to diversify in terms of oyster species grown?
Yeah, Jordan Shane here. Absolutely. The industry, in New South Wales, after POMS affected their Pacific oyster industry, they've largely moved towards rock oysters, which they do now. In South Australia, there's a push to think about farming other species. So native flat oysters are an example of other species that the industry are pretty keen to start farming as well, just to spread the risk.
Yeah. Luckily, they're all delicious. Bryce has asked, and I think this might be a good one for you, Mark. What commercial growing region is the highest risk of getting POMS and why? Mark, you there?
Yep, sorry. Well, that's a good question. I think the modelling outcomes kind of are presented, that they'll present shortly, show the increased risks, but there's definitely some connectivity between farm regions on the far west coast around Ceduna, which means due to the oceanographic connectivity and the warm temperatures, that there's probably an increased risk. And ports in the area of, if the disease did get into there, there's a lot more connectivity over there.
Okay, and that was a great question from Bryce. Scott has asked, have you thought of using environmental DNA to detect POMS? Could be used as a potential early detection technique.
Yeah, Jordan Shane here, that's a great question. And Saadi have actually been looking at exactly that. They've had a project looking at, essentially, well, in simple terms, collecting water samples in various regions and seeing whether they can detect the DNA. And they've done that across Australia, and it seems quite promising, actually, as another surveillance tool.
Okay. And Dan has asked, perhaps jumping the gun here, but wondering how this site-specific knowledge can be rolled out to POMS disease risk in other aquaculture areas, and could the tool also be applied to the impacts of oyster farming from pollutant sources such as sewage overflow?
Yeah, Jordan, Shaney, I can have a go at that one. In terms of this model and this technique being used to predict spread of disease, I'm not aware of it being used in other states for POMS. I mean, it has been used elsewhere around the world, for example, sea lice and salmon aquaculture. But it can be, and I'll touch on this again towards the end of my talk, it can be used for a whole range of other things, including, predicting spread of pollutants, harmful algae, for example, et cetera. So I'll touch on that at the end of my talk. Good question.
Okay, fantastic. Yeah, great question. And we love to get as many questions as we can to these experts. It's your chance to ask them anything that you want. So our final Q&A session is coming up in just a bit. So we'll get more of your questions then. Don't worry about waiting till that time. Start sending them in as soon as you think of them. Frank is now going to tell us how the Bureau's ocean models have helped fight the disease. Take it away, Frank.
Thanks, Jordan. And good morning, everyone. Thanks for listening in. I'm going to talk about the ocean modeling at the Bureau of Meteorology. I'm trying to tie this back in with what Mark just talked about and how the Bureau was going to help with analyzing the Pacific Oyster Mortality Syndrome causing virus outbreak in South Australia. So I'll start with the question, what is an ocean model? And overall, we can see this as a representation in the form of mathematical equations that we're putting into computer code with the aim to describe the physical processes of the ocean. So what does it mean? What we're looking at mostly, it's mainly temperature, salinity, ocean currents, and sea surface height. On the upper left, I'll show you a schematic of, to give you an understanding of how we could construct an ocean model. Basically, we could divide up the ocean, the global ocean or region of it, into little cubes. We can make those cubes smaller, we can make them larger, and the size of those cubes would determine the resolution of the ocean model. A smaller cube size would mean a finer or higher resolution, and you can imagine that with that, we can fit the coastline or topographic features of an area better. So it is in general desirable to have a high resolution, however, it comes with a numerical cost. So models take longer to run and they're also more expensive. A different kind of models On the lower left, I show you a snapshot of a global ocean model that we're running operationally at the Bureau of Meteorology. That model, we call it Ocean Maps. And this gives you a snapshot of velocities south of Australia. There's regional models, two examples shown here on the right. The upper model was a model we developed for the Great Barrier Reef. On the lower right, you see a model that we developed in collaboration with Saudi for South Australian ocean region. Now, why are we doing ocean modeling? We are generally often interested in extreme events for sea level, for example, that means storm surges, storm tides, or tsunamis. They can lead to flooding or erosion. So we want to know about those. In terms of temperature or extreme warm temperatures, they can lead to thermal stress. For reefs, we know this can lead to coral bleaching. It can also affect fish habitats. And fish can migrate because of a change in temperatures, and this may affect fisheries at some stage. Now, ocean currents, which is the more important aspect of this study we've been doing, the currents, they move things around. They can transport water, warm water or cold water. They can transport sediments. In the lower middle here, I show you a beautiful picture of a river discharge event that includes some sediments. So it's a sediment plume. You can see that will be moved around by the currents. Currents transport particles, and this includes viruses. And therefore, what the Bureau was bringing to the table in this particular study was the knowledge of ocean currents and the capability to model those. Ocean currents can also be used to optimize ship routing, and this has an impact on fisheries, a positive one. And they can be used to search and rescue missions. Observations. We need to understand how good or how bad our ocean models perform in certain areas. And there's really only one way to understand that, and that is to compare the model results with observations. At these days, we have a range of observations at our disposals. We've got satellites, we've got fixed moorings, we've got drifters that move around with currents. On the lower image here, I give you an idea of how well we can cover observations around of Australia over a certain, I think, a 5-year time period. And this is taken from the Australian Ocean Data Network, facilitated by the Integrated Marine Observing System. You can see coverage of surface temperatures is generally really good, coming from the satellites. You see here these straight lines are ships of opportunities. Ships can be equipped with measuring devices that measure temperatures or salinity. This blue patch is taken from a high frequency radar that's land-based, and that measures ocean currents. And then in yellow, these yellow dots are referred to Argo floats. They're looking like these bits here. And these Argo floats really revolutionized our understanding of the ocean. They're autonomous machines. Basically, they drift within the currents. They can move up to the surface and up to a depth of 2,000 meters by themselves. And we can use the data. They're measuring temperature profiles during that time, and we can use that data. So all of these observations are ingested by the Bureau. We use them firstly to compare our models against them, and to see where we are doing a good job or where we can improve our model results. And secondly, we also use these observations to combine them or merge them with the ocean model simulations. And this is a process we call data simulation, and it's very important to do that because that gives us good forecast qualities and modeling in general. On this slide, I show you surface ocean currents around Australia, taken from our global ocean model, Ocean Maps. It's a going to be an animation I'm going to show you. It's about 2 years long, and the reason why I'm trying to show you is I want to get the point across that the ocean models are anything but static. In the following, the darker bits describe fast moving currents, while the lighter bits are weaker currents. It's going to start this animation. And you can see the currents break up, they meander here. There's a lot of movement in this whole picture.
There's currents coming down over the Great Barrier Reef, the East Australian Current, leading to these little features here. We call them ocean eddies. They can persist for a very long time. On the west, you can see also these little eddies, but at times the Lewin Current coming down here, it could stretch all the way along to Victoria. There's interbasin connections. You see currents coming from the Pacific via the Indonesian archipelago and towards the Indian Ocean. So there's a fairly complex image that emerges, and I think you can understand the variability in the ocean. However, this picture is missing one substantial motion, and that's associated with tidal movements, and that's okay for the global ocean model. But once we come towards the coast, we need to include these tidal currents in our simulations because they're such a dominant part of the variability in the coast. And how we do this, we go with a nested model approach, and that's schematically shown here what it means. On the left slide, on the left image shows you the global ocean maps model. That's a 10 kilometer resolution model. It does not include tides, and therefore it does not include tidal currents. And you can see this 10 kilometer resolution gives you not the best representation of the coastline. Some of these islands are likely too large, and some of these straits are probably too narrow. But what this model does, it gives temperature, salinity, and velocities to our nested model. The nested model include additionally forcing terms for the tides. So this model is of higher resolution. It includes the tides and the tidal currents. And you can see those here. There's a bit of a circular motion due to the periodicity coming from the tides. The coastline is also very well represented. Now, this model I just shown you, and this is shown here in this image as well, is what we call the ESA Marine Ocean Model. And we developed this in collaboration with SARDI. We can run this as a forecast model, or we can run it over previous periods. And this is what we call a reanalysis when we're interested in previous oceanic conditions. This model includes data simulation. So again, it combines the observation with model results. And what it means is that this data set we are having here at our disposal is the best available oceanographic, say, atlas for the ocean south of Australia. And this brings us back to what Mark's been talking about, and back to the Pacific Oyster Mortality Syndrome. How did the Bureau actually contributes towards looking at the POMS? And basically what we did is we were taking the ocean currents from the reanalysis I just showed you, and we're trying to aim to model the viral particle dispersals at these key locations. They included the commercial oyster growing areas, feral oyster populations, and ports. And we incorporated the seasonal oceanographic parameters because we know there's a dependency on the virus survival rate with the seasons, and there's a temperature dependency on that. So we did a bunch of sensitivity studies in order to understand the spread of the virus in different conditions. And here I'm giving you an example of how this modeling exercise looks like. As Mark already alluded to, we're feeding these currents from our ocean model into a particle transport model called Eltrans. And this model moves around particles, and these are representatives of the virus in this case. We're adding 1,000 particles per hour, and then we model this over a certain time period for different locations. And I would like to show you an animation right now that gives you an idea how this how these particles are affected within the ocean currents. Let's start that now. And this is for, I think, for Coffin Bay area. You see after in gray, so we're adding particles, and in gray, these are the particle plume. We cannot discern a single particles because we're adding too many over time. We're adding 1,000 per hour. But what we can see is that these particles in gray, they move northward. There's a coastal current that transports them. On top of that movement, we've got this circular or periodic movement caused by the tidal current. So then squeezing and stretching the plume. And after 22 days, that's how long the stimulation is, we can see that the plume has a maximum extent of roughly 300 kilometers. We've got these lines, which we can look around. They give you the maximum extent of this virus plume. coming to the last slide, and here's another example on the products that have been generated from the model simulations. They're very similar to what we've seen before. Just this map gives you the distribution of the virus over here, over Pearl River. And the red line indicates the 2-day mark. Mark alluded to this before. We know the virus can survive about 2 days in the open ocean. After that, it dies or cannot move on. So all the viruses that have been transported further out are basically not live viruses anymore, but we can detect them genetically. Okay, I'd like to sum this up. The Bureau is firstly is running ocean models. They're different in size and in resolution. They include different physics, and one of the main product the Bureau generated for this project was the ocean currents. They were used to simulate the spread of the virus under different oceanic conditions. And potentially, and I imagine Shane is talking a bit more about this, they allowed for the generation of maps like these that may be able to help the management of oyster farms. They surely give a first guidance on how far and quick the virus can spread. And with that, I'd like to hand over to Sean, and I'd also like to thank you very much for listening.
Okay, thanks for that, Frank. So I'm going to provide a few slides on the impacts and outcomes for industry. Next slide, please. So we've touched on this already, but in terms of impact, the POMS disease made its way to Australia in 2010. Around Sydney Harbour area. It affected the Pacific oyster growing regions around the Georges River. And it, as you can see from these news article clippings, that had a significant impact. New South Wales did well at containing it, but 3 years later, it made it to the Hawkesbury River growing region in New South Wales, where it decimated the farms there. In 2016, it made its way to Tasmania. So it was detected around the oyster farming regions around Hobart. In 2016 alone, in Tasmania, there was over $12 million worth of stock loss, over 100 regional jobs lost, and the government spent over $10 million in terms of emergency response and recovery. So that was 2016 alone. So the take home here is it's a significant disease in terms of socioeconomic. Next slide, please. As Mark's talked about, in 2018, the virus was detected in Port Adelaide River. So Saudi researchers happened to be out in the port. On the left-hand side there, you can see wild or feral oysters along, you know, the wharf and the pontoons. The bottom left, you can see oysters visibly have recently died. The meat doesn't last too long at all, so these are fresh dead oysters. The middle there, the middle map, we quickly, once we had the detection, so using DNA techniques, so PCR, we embarked on rapid surveillance to see where is it actually in the port to start with. So that map there, you can see the red PCR positive. So virus positive samples of oysters and the green negative. So you can see in short over the next kind of, and we tracked it over the next few weeks, it slowly made its way throughout the whole port. Next slide, please. So while we had measures as part of our emergency response, we had measures in place to try and contain the virus to the port. You can see on the right hand side there, there's a bivalve shellfish closures. That means fishers were banned from taking any bivalves, so oysters or mussels. There's a lot of signage around the area as well. You can see that in the top right hand corner. We were managing vessel movements, talking to different vessel companies about cleaning or having their vessels clean before they leave the port. But importantly, the big question right up front was, okay, was it anywhere else in the state? So we immediately stopped all oyster movements because part of the commercial farming is moving oysters between regions. That's because some regions have better algae than others, better for growing small oysters compared to large oysters. So the whole industry did really well at stopping movement. And then we embarked on a big surveillance program across the whole state to see whether the virus is actually anywhere else. So that's proof of freedom surveillance, which I'll talk about next. So next slide, please. So you can see here, again, you've seen this map a few times. So those circles are approximately 10K circles around each growing region. So from the literature before we did this study, we had to assume that the virus could travel about 10 kilometres away. So we're able to separate all the different growing regions, and that's how we did our surveillance program. So this type of surveillance is called proof of freedom. So back in 2018, we tested enough oysters in all those regions, and we were confident then with all those negative results that the virus hadn't impacted and wasn't about to kill wild farmed oysters. The industry were really good at reporting any low level mortality, which we would also quickly investigate. So Frank had just shown you, the modelling that Sardi and the Bureau did for us during the emergency response was absolutely pivotal. It showed and demonstrated that the virus wasn't going to be moving out of the port to those growing regions across the other side of the Gulf, which are about 60 kilometres away. So that was a huge relief for farmers and us, of course. And since 2018, we've been doing this surveillance program a couple of times a year. So we've now got over 15,000 oyster samples that are negative. So in effect, it's kind of validated that the virus isn't moving through water any more than, like you saw the map that Frank showed, about 25 k's maximum from the port. Next slide, please. So in terms of outcomes, the key outcomes of this project, I've talked about surveillance and it's greatly improved surveillance design. So the type of surveillance we now have across the state is early detection surveillance. So that's where it's risk-based design. We sample oysters close to ports, for example, and marinas in those areas. On the left-hand side here, you can see this is the York Peninsula Disease Management Areas. It's the York Peninsula growing region. And there's about three different sites where the farms are based. And this is an example of how you can improve your surveillance design by sampling where the highest risks are. So you can see on that side of the Gulf, the plume based on ocean currents. And oceanographic parameters, the plume is moving in a northerly direction. So if you've got, if you happen to have virus at the most southerly point, then it's a pretty high risk and likelihood that those farms in the north are going to be infected anyway. However, if the virus happens to appear in the north, it's unlikely that you'll see it very soon in the south because of the direction. So you could bias your sampling for the York Peninsula growing area and sample more oysters in the northern parts. And that kind of improves your surveillance detection. So that's one example. Next slide, please. Another outcome is we've now been able to refine and improve our disease management areas. So that slide on the left that you've seen before, that was our old map of the growing regions. What we can do now, based on this oceanographic modelling, you can see that the regions are now being designed around those predicted plumes. So a good example, in the top left-hand corner of that the map down the right, you can see the Smoky Bay and Denial Bay regions have now been merged. They're now treated as one growing area, whereas it used to be two, and that's based on this modelling. Industry have also adopted this in terms of they now call that one growing region. So from a disease management and perspective, if we happen to get the virus up in that area, we know that there's a high likelihood it's going to spread through the farms in that area there. And if it's only detected in the one area, then we can aim to try and contain it so it doesn't spread to the rest of the state. So that's another good example of an outcome of the project. Next slide, please. Yep, so both surveillance and those disease management areas have now been incorporated into policy. So an example is our South Australian Disease Response Plan for POMS. Like I said, industry have also adopted these. And, you know, this oceanographic information can now be considered in our emergency response planning and any responses in the future. It's now written into the plan that, you know, how we can engage the Bureau as well as SARDI into any emergency response, and they can provide rapid predictions of during an outbreak, which is going to greatly assist our responses in the future. Next slide, please. So overall, this kind of ocean modelling has given us confidence that POMS is contained just to the port, and it cannot spread to those adjacent farming areas, which are over 60 kilometres away. So now that it's given us and the industry that kind of confidence, we've been able to manage those other risk areas, which is around vessel movements, biofouling, and banning, for example, fishing of bivalves from the port. So you can see on the news clipping there on the right, the industry is happy, healthy, and thriving. And you know, this has demonstrated that our oceanographic models are a really useful tool for particle tracking, for disease surveillance, as well as emergency disease response. Next slide, please. In terms of broader outcomes for other aquaculture industries and fisheries, you can see some previous research that we've done here. These types of biophysical modelling have been used before for predicting and tracking harmful algae blooms, as well as marine heat waves. Some of you may remember the 2013 fish kill around Australia, South Australia. This modelling was used during the response to that and provided really useful information on those blooms and where they were tracking. We've also used it for other harmful algae blooms since then, which happened from time to time. And it's really important for the oyster, for the aquaculture industry, for example, because if these ocean models are showing that a harmful algae bloom is tracking towards an aquaculture area, then at least we can prepare and possibly even move stock if we have to out of that way. Frank earlier talked about how the ocean models have been used to provide more efficient routes for vessels. That's been the case in the tuna industry as well, for example. It's been used to help predict storm surges, even nutrient plumes from aquaculture when we're establishing a new area. And it helps us, and you can see in the bottom left-hand corner there, and that helps us effectively regulate and manage aquaculture to ensure that nutrient plumes are at a low risk level, but also it helps us identify where to do environmental monitoring. And lastly, it can also be used in fisheries to predict and track larval recruitment. An example there is when we did this in 2016 for the corn fishing industry. That's it from me. Back to you, Jordan. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Shane. I hope that gives you a lot of information on how we're using weather and climate science to help the aquaculture industry. Now we have a great opportunity for you to ask some questions to all of our panelists. So please start sending them in and we'll get to as many as we can. And we've gotten some fantastic ones, like from Martina, who has asked, what is the vertical distribution of the virus in the environment? Do you think it sinks to the sediments and can be suspended to reinfect oysters?
Yeah, hi Jordan, it's Mark here. As you could see in the opening slides, the virus itself is very small. So basically, in terms of modelling it and our understanding, as I mentioned, it's just a passive particle, it's washed around. But I'd expect in the real environment, the ocean is something like a polymer matrix. It's a little bit sticky and there's fecal material and other organic matter floating around from fish poo, detritus of broken down algae. So I'd expect the virus to be able to attach to those small particles in the ocean, and potentially they have low settling velocities that will, you know, essentially mean that they do. Once stirring and mixing in the ocean subsides from time to time, can settle down. But I think that's an area of active research.
Okay, I might get you to stay there, Mark, because Ivan has sent in a question that I think is a good one for you. Is it a new virus, or what was the situation before 2018?
I'm going to pass that one over to Shane. Thank you.
Oh, my mistake.
Yeah. Jordan. So this is this disease, this virus first emerged in Europe in 2008, I think it was. But it's called an Austrian herpes virus microvariant. So it's a strain of the more typical Austrian herpes virus, and it became a very highly pathogenic and virulent strain. Started affecting oyster industries around the world. And like I said earlier, it actually made it to both New Zealand and Sydney in 2010. It's the same strain that's made its way to South Australia in 2018.
Okay. Rebecca just wanted a little clarification. How does it remain in the environment if it dies after 2 days?
Yeah, that's a good question. So, although it dies, obviously the DNA or the virus will decompose over time. The PCR diagnostic techniques that we have, what it's doing is it's detecting a small fragment of the DNA. So after the virus will die in water, and that's from lab trials, after the 2 days, the virus dies, but you can still detect it using those DNA PCR techniques for up to about 22 days. And for us, that was really important to model all the way through to 22 days, because we could get a PCR detection on the other side of the Gulf, but it may not be live virus. So it was really useful information to model the virus right up to the 22-day mark.
Okay. Beth has a question for Frank. For the South Australian modelling, to what depth was the modelling undertaken and what resolution at depth?
Thanks, Jordan. The ocean model we implemented for the South Australian region has quite a variable resolution over the depth. So basically we were employing a model that follows the topography. It's a bit of a complication of what I actually shown and how we construct models. In this case, we are following the topography, and that means the ocean model, the depth or the layer thicknesses we are having within this ocean model varies depending on how deep the model, how deep the topography is. And this has advantages because that means we always have the same amount of vertical layers in that ocean model, but over the shallow area or the shelf, which is where we usually employ this model to be useful for, we get a better vertical resolution. In general, the resolution is higher over at the surface areas. So it can range from 50 centimeters up to a meter, but then over the deeper areas, it can be depending on the bottom or the topography depth, it can be up to 100, or the thickness layers can be up to 500 meter large over a 5 kilometer ocean depth. But over the shelf, I'd say it's about up to 20 meter thickness for the lower levels.
Okay. Ian has asked for some clarification on the spread of the virus from New South Wales to Tasmania. Were there other vectors, or is it just the East Coast current is faster?
Yeah, Shane here. So what we've now got some pretty good evidence through some of the SARDI research, for example, that the main vector is shipping and vessels. We've actually taken some bivalves, including Pacific oysters, off of some heavily fouled vessels, and they have tested positive. So the thinking now in the science community is it's more likely to be traveling between areas, large, like jurisdictions and countries, through vessel movement. As you saw in this modeling, I mean, the furthest distance really was the kind of 20 to 25K area that the virus can move through currents. But I mean, if it hits another feral or wild population, then it can slowly move through infected populations. We're fairly lucky here in South Australia. Our growing regions and our Pacific oyster populations have quite spread across the state.
Okay, and I think this might be the last question because we're running out of time, but Bryce has asked, so South Australia has higher salinity in many growing regions when compared to other states or countries producing Pacific oysters. How does salinity affect the presence of the POMS outbreak?
Yeah, that's a good question from Bryce. And I think that's really an area of current research still. Temperature we have is quite a huge significant effect. The virus essentially goes inactive in those colder months. And it's quite active and replicating and being transmissible during warmer months. So temperature is the biggest factor here. Salinity, quite possibly, but I think that's more of a current area of research.
Okay, so a lot of information to take in there, but if you missed the start, Mark, would you like to summarise what we spoke about today and more importantly, where people can find more information?
I think if we flick to the next slide, there's some more information on.
Okay, yeah.
There we go. So there's some links for those that are looking at the presentation. In summary, we know that the POMS virus was introduced into South Australia in 2018. So as a part of the emergency response and safeguarding the industry, we needed to understand the virus and undertake some modelling further understand how transmissible it is around the state and what the likelihood of different oyster growing regions around our state are of getting infected from one to the other. So we worked with our biologists and ocean modelers from the Bureau and SARDI to be able to develop oyster management plans for to better manage and advise the industry.
Excellent. And just a quick note that if you'd like to deep dive on this very topic, then you can view our BOM blog. It has an in-depth article online right now, and the link will be in the chat. Don't worry about copying down those links either, because the presentation will be sent around and you'll be able to click through on the PPT. So if you want to get more information on your favorite platform, why not connect with us on social media or through our excellent BOM weather app? And you can subscribe to receive direct updates to your inbox from the Bureau about everything the team have talked about today or more information on upcoming webinars. Next slide, please. For our next webinar, we will be focusing on our next season. I'll get you to jump to the next one as well. Sorry, Frank. The Spring 2021 Climate and Water Update is coming on September 2nd. We've put a lot of effort into our change of season webinars so you can make the right decisions for the months ahead. If you'd like to come along, a link will be dropped in the chat now for you to join us. And that brings us to the end of today's webinar. A big thank you to Mark, Frank, Frank and Shane for all your time in developing the content and sharing your knowledge with us. And thanks to Marg and Lucy for your work behind the scenes. And to you, thank you for tuning in and joining us today. We hope you enjoyed this session and we do hope you'll join us again next time. If you'd like to continue the conversation, please use the hashtag BOMWebinar in your LinkedIn posts. As mentioned earlier, this session has been recorded and we will have the video ready for your on-demand viewing pleasure in the next couple of days. So watch this space along with all the presentation materials as well. Finally, but most importantly, we want your feedback. It's our aim to bring you the highest possible quality webinars, but we can't do that unless you share your experiences with us. So once this once we close this webinar, a short survey will pop up on the screen and we're very grateful if you could complete that anonymously for us. Once again, thank you for your time and we look forward to seeing you again soon. Goodbye.